Hello, Balboa Scholars. It is so good to be with you all again. I can't wait for the rest of our lesson. We have something really special planned for today. So with that, let's get started. Stand up if you're not already.
Take a deep breath in. Let it out. Deep breath in. Let it out. One more deep breath in. Let it out. Big stretch. You just woke up. Roll your shoulders forward 5 times. 3, 4, 5. Roll them back 5 times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Roll your wrists around and your fingers. Just feel loose. Crack your knuckles if you need to, or your fingers. Very good. One more deep breath in. Now reach up as high as you can. Stretch up onto your tippy toes. Get as straight as you can, and then slowly go down and touch your toes if you can. Feel a stretch in the back of your legs. And just hang there for a second. Now don't go up too quickly. Just slowly stand up. And when your head gets to the top, roll it around a few times in one direction. Don't go too quickly. You have to be nice and relaxed today. Go the other direction. One more deep breath in, and then out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0. Hold it. Don't let it go. Let it out like you're letting it out through a straw. Shh. Massage your jaw for a little bit. Feel nice and loose. Massage your temples. And clap your hands together. Ah, just kidding. Together. Woo! And shh, shh, shh. He, he, he. Ha, ha, ha. And with that, please take a seat. Now, moving on to Zumba rhythm. For Zumba rhythm, the only thing that we're going to be adding, along with ta, titi, tiki tiki, grasshopper, cinnamon, is we are going to add in syncopa from last time. Here we go. As we can see, our first rhythm will be syncopa. So if this is our beat, it's gonna sound like this. Syncopa. Ready? Go. Syncopa, ti-ti-ta. Syncopa, ti-ti-ta. Tiki-tiki-ti-ti. Syncopa, tiki-tiki-ti-ti. Syncopa. Cinnamon grasshopper, tiki-tiki-ti-ti. Cinnamon grasshopper, tiki-tiki-ti. Tiki-tiki, syncopa, tiki-tiki. Good. So this one isn't as challenging, necessarily, but as it speeds up, it's gonna get a lot harder. One, two, ready, go. Syncopa, ti-ti-ta. Tiki-tiki-ti-ti, syncopa. Cinnamon grasshopper, tiki-tiki-ti-ti. Tiki-tiki, syncopa, tiki-tiki. Make sure you don't rush through syncopa. Even I want to, so stay in control. One, two, ready, go. Syncopa, ti-ti-ta. Tiki-tiki-ti-ti, syncopa. Cinnamon, grasshopper, tiki-tiki-ti-ti. Tiki-tiki, syncopa, tiki-tiki. Awesome job. Okay, here we go, the extra fast one. One, two, ready, go. Syncopa, ti-ti-ta. Tiki-tiki-ti-ti, syncopa. Cinnamon, grasshopper, tiki-tiki-ti-ti. Tiki-tiki, syncopa, tiki-tiki. Awesome job, everybody. Let's move on. The next activity will be your grade's episode of Rhythm Wars. Here we go. Fourth and fifth graders, we're going to learn a new rhythm today, and we're going to practice it in our episode of Rhythm Wars. So, first of all, good job using syncopa last week. I know it was review for all of us, but good job going through it. This next rhythm that we're learning is somewhat related to it. If we have syncopa here, it fills up two beats, right? This other rhythm also fills up two beats. Now, basically what we're gonna do to get it is we're gonna combine these two notes into one single note, this same length, and then we're gonna have an eighth note at the very end, which looks like this. Boom. Now we have a quarter note with a dot after it. That basically stands for one of our eighth notes. A quick thing in case you don't know when it comes to how long notes are and how many beats they fill up, whenever you see a dot, it always means plus half the original amount of the thing that we're looking at. So here we have a quarter note, which fills up one beat, right? So the dot tells us that we need to add half of a quarter note, which is an eighth note. So this fills up 1.5 beats. We're gonna call this Tom T, like this. Tom T, Tom T. And you'll realize that the T in Tom T is the same spot that we have pa in syncopa. All we have to do is just hold out the word or syllable, tom. Tom, t, tom, t. So that was two of them in a row. Why don't we do four in a row a little bit quicker? One, two, ready, go. Tom, t, tom, t, tom, t, tom, t. Good. Now let's do it a little bit faster. One, two, ready, go. Tom, T, Tom, T, Tom, T, Tom, T. Very good. Let's put it to practice.
For today's lesson, we are going to focus on conducting. In just a few moments, I'm going to show you a video that's a really good introduction and review to who a conductor is, what their job is, and how do they do it. But I wanted to remind us and teach us a couple of key words or ideas that we might encounter in these videos. The first is baton. A baton is the tool that conductors use to make sure that whatever they do or whatever they gesture is able to be seen clearly by a very large orchestra over a large space. Now, it's worth noting that conductors don't always use a baton, that usually people like choral conductors, so any conductors that are conducting a choir or a group of singers, will not use a baton. They will just use their hands in the same way that you would use a baton. So that's what this is. Our second word is time signature. A time signature shows us how many beats are going to be grouped together, both in how they sound and also in the way they're written out on a piece of music. The two time signatures we're going to refer to today are 4-4 and 3-4. To quickly review, 4-4 organizes our music into 4 beats at a time, and 3-4 organizes them into 3 beats at a time. We're going to take this idea of time signatures and we're going to apply it to this next very important idea, pattern or gesture. I'm going to use the word pattern today. Pattern refers to the way that a conductor moves their hand or the baton to indicate or to show how many beats are grouped together at a time. So if a piece, as an example, is in 3-4, they will do a gesture or a pattern that's based on 3 beats, like this. 1, 2, 3. If you're doing 4-4, it looks like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. But moving on to our next key idea, dynamics. We learned about dynamics in last week's lesson, so let's quickly review the things that we learned. From softest to loudest, it goes pianissimo, piano, mezzo piano, mezzo forte, forte, and fortissimo. Conductors use the size of their gesture to indicate how loudly or softly instrumentalists or singers are supposed to be playing or singing. Now we're going to watch a video that takes all these ideas and shows us exactly, like I said, who a conductor is, what their job is, and how they do it.
If you've ever seen an orchestra, choir, or band perform, you've probably seen a conductor in action. To the untrained eye, the conductor's job might seem like glorified stick waving, but he or she is in fact a vital member of the ensemble, whose talent measurably improves the performance. The most basic role of a conductor is to keep the performers playing together. A musical piece is divided into measures, each with a specified number of beats. Beats are evenly spaced pulses in the music, and the conductor will demonstrate when these beats should occur with hand gestures. These hand gestures might be emphasized with a baton, but many conductors choose to use only their hands, in an effort to provide more expressiveness. While conductors can technically signal beats with whatever gestures they would like, there are some basic patterns that have become standard. For example, if a piece of music has 3 beats in each measure, this pattern is often used. Within this pattern, each beat has an ictus, or a precise moment that signals when the beat should occur. The first beat in the measure, also called the downbeat, is the strongest and most important, so it is signaled with a large downward gesture, with the ictus finally occurring at the bottom of the pattern. In order to make the location of the ictus perfectly clear, the conductor rebounds slightly after each beat. A good conductor ensures that his or her gestures are clear to the ensemble, and conductors who are less visible, like a drum major conducting a marching band, use more rigid conducting patterns to compensate. All of this technique might seem a bit like overkill. Surely a group of well-trained musicians can play together simply by listening to each other. To a certain extent, this is true, and small groups like brass ensembles or barbershop quartets might perform perfectly well without a conductor. However, the larger an ensemble becomes, the more necessary it is for the musicians to have a visual reference for the beat. This is because sound takes time to travel across the ensemble, so if a tuba player is listening to a violinist to determine where the beats in the measure are, the tuba player will be consistently playing too late. With a visual reference for the beat, however, both the tuba player and the violinist play their music in sync, even if it doesn't sound like it to them. In an orchestra or choir, these sound delays are very slight, but can build up over the course of the piece and throw the musicians out of sync. In a marching band, however, players on opposite sides of the field will play nearly a third of a second out of sync if they rely on their ears instead of their eyes. Small ensembles are close enough together that this sound delay is negligible, but they still choose one player as an authority to signal the beginning of the piece and set the tempo or speed of the piece. Aside from preventing the ensemble from derailing, the conductor is also the authority on the interpretation of the piece. Most stylistic directions in music are left vague, so the conductor will determine whether a phrase should be played more loudly, more delicately, or more sorrowfully. In addition, the piece may contain fermatas, indicating that a note should be held, or caesuras, indicating that the music should briefly pause, and it is the conductor's job to determine exactly when to resume the piece. These stylistic decisions are communicated either with the conductor's free hand or with the style of the conducting pattern itself. Lastly, the conductor serves as a mediator between the ensemble and the audience. Their visual performance gives important signals to the audience about what is happening in the piece, both stylistically and technically. For example, during the pause between movements within a larger piece, the conductor will keep his or her arms raised and attention focused on the orchestra. But when the conductor relaxes and turns, this signals that the piece is over and the audience may applaud. Conductors often represent the ensemble in public as well, and are the figurehead receiving the fame and glory on behalf of the ensemble. Many also serve as educators and music advocates in their spare time. The next time you see an orchestra, choir, or band perform, take note of what the conductor is doing and see if you can pick out the signals he or she is sending to the ensemble. It may help you to recognize some of the subtleties in the performance and give you a better appreciation for the work that goes into helping an entire ensemble cooperate to make music.
I wanted to give you another example before we get to our activity so that you could really understand what I think is maybe the most important part of a conductor's job. Not only are they supposed to be up there during a performance, but they also are in charge of making sure the orchestra or the choir, whoever they are conducting, creates a cohesive sound and that they all know what story they're trying to tell through the music. I want you to watch a video of one of the most famous conductors in the world. His name is Gustavo Dudamel, and he conducts the LA Philharmonic, which actually lives right here in Los Angeles. This is a video of their rehearsal, so they're all practicing this piece together, and I want you to see some of the things that he's doing in order to create an even better sound. Because the thing is, the LA Phil is one of the best orchestras in the world. They could play almost anything really well right off the bat. But Dudamel's job, the conductor's job, is to take things from good and make them great. So I want you to see the ways that he does it.
Everything in the point of justo. You know, justo means justo. You know, it's an allegro, let's say, it's an allegro in control. I think that keep more this dramatic feeling holding the tempo, not in ritardando or in pesante, but holding all the time the tempo. With the chance to be espressivo there, okay? Two before Dolorita. This jump pan tan tan, we have to be a little bit more pam pam. You know, they start tin pam 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 pam. Two before D. Three and. From the second beat, second 16. Detaché. Okay? Which letter is the complete passage? E. E. Yes, exactly. More bow. Let's say. E, three, and.
hope you guys found that really cool. I love that part in the end when all of a sudden the strings play that part exactly the way that he wanted them to, and it added this extra element, this extra excitement to the music, which was really cool. If you've enjoyed the videos that I've given you, there's one more I'm gonna put in the link below. This one is probably more for 3rd, 4th, and 5th graders, but if you're in 1st and 2nd grade and you really like this stuff, please watch it. It's very interesting. The link is below in the description of the video. Whew. Okay, we've talked too much and you guys have listened to a lot of things. So we're going to continue talking about conducting and practicing it ourselves in next week's video. I wanted to split things up just because we had so much to cover. So with that, stay tuned for next week and our very exciting activity. I'm super, super stoked to be able to do it with you guys. With that, have a wonderful week and I miss you all so much. Take care. Bye, guys.